submitted to the National Assembly by President Muhammadu Buhari last week. I have in the studio Yushau Aliu, an economist. Welcome to the program.
Good morning and compliment of the season.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah. The federal government described the budget as a budget of continuity to continue with some of the projects and sustain the growth they have seen in the economy. The Senate President Bukola Saraki said it is the budget of hopelessness. Now, Yushau Aliu, I'm going to give you the next 2 minutes to describe this 2019 budget. So many people are describing it their own way. What do you describe it as?
It's a budget of commitment. Budget of commitment in the sense that there has been a commitment under medium-term expenditure framework, meaning that it's a budget that has to do with 3 years lifespan coverage. When budget reaction is coming from an arm of government that is a budget of hopelessness, we just regard that as political statement, looking at the fact that the 2018 medium-term expenditure framework was not called budget of hopelessness. And also for the government also to call the budget of continuity, also is also political. And that's why in economics we have to balance the situation. It's just a commitment of the government. And in any society, you have to balance resources against commitment. So whatever you are committing into the any plan or any appropriation is just an attempt to commit yourself. So it is left for us, the analysts and also the citizen, to look at the commitment, whether it is impacting or whether it is not impacting, and what to be done to make adjustment where possible.
Okay, we are talking about sustaining growth. That's what the government is talking about, and especially around those parameters, around ERGP, to ensure that it yields the desired result. And now the budget has been reduced from over 9 trillion to about 8.8 trillion. Are we sincere with the growth we want to stimulate in the economy?
Sincerity or purpose has to do with what the results on ground. Looking at 9.1 trillion of 2018, the executive has an argument that they have presented 8.6 trillion in 2018. So by presenting 8.8 trillion is higher by commitment, looking at the fact that what was committed in 2018 budget was just to cover some electioneering funding and possibly security challenges. So but the former Minister of Finance has said it categorically that they are going to sustain no matter what the tense situation or the situation on ground, they are going to look at the method of refinancing the budget. That is one. Two, also they are going to look at the issue of debt to GDP situation on ground. So, and looking carefully into it, it's not different, but we have an argument. Everybody can have an argument, but the fact that it's an instrument that must pass through that level, and it is meant for the executive to initiate and present to the National Assembly. So,
will either increase or reduce?
Either increase or, but it is the responsibility of the executive to make a presentation, to look at the content by the National Assembly within their various committees. And it is good for democracy, because what democracy is always trying to bring in economic activity is to bring fairness and efficiency. But we want the argument from us economists or those public commentators is we want the executive to be more efficient in presenting the budget. So also we want the legislators to be more efficient in scrutinizing the appropriation. And also
and we that we have it on time.
Yes, and also want the key players, that is the MDAs and ministries, to be proactive in trying to push, especially the Minister of Finance, because it is the responsibility of an arm of government under budget office to present the budget. And budget always have a life cycle. And also, budget has a lot of contentions and controversies. And that is why the commitment that is put within the same framework has to be carefully done and has to be done in time, and also how to go along with the financial calendar of business or private investments.
Okay, now let's look at the capital spend. Ideally, it's 26%, but when you put other implementation, we're talking about 30%. The federal government, since the inception of this administration, has been doing 30%, as against what we had before. Now, we have a deficit in infrastructure, so much that so much is needed to offset that deficit. And we're still talking about 30% after 3 years or 4 years. Are we going anywhere closer to trying to offset this deficit?
We are going, but not closer, because efficiently, if you are to balance the commitment, there are three basic components that are very significant in our funding process. One, the type of funds we are using, the source of funds we are using, and also the volume. When the debt ratio to the budget is 20, for instance, debt servicing is 20 to 80 ratio. Yeah, it is so significant. So even if you are talking of probably 30-70, when you go into debt issue, you find a situation under the same ratio that it is not what we are trying to explain. But however, since 1999, the advent of this modern democracy, up to the 8th Senate Senate or to this about fifth transition, there has been no effort to change the calendar, and changing the calendar means a lot in changing our attitude, because developmental economists all the time, including W.W. Rostow, postulated that unless you change attitude, government has to change attitude, I have to change attitude, ITV has to change attitude. Attitude toward positive development. Positive development using good parameters. Parameters that have world standard. World standard in finance, world standard in execution, world standard in monitoring. You cannot have all this if you have the same budget. So if you have the same budget strategy, the same budget presentation, it is presented. The one that the 2018 budget was presented earlier, and it doesn't have much political controversy like the one of 2019. The 2019 is also having much difficulty in the sense that the APC was not able to manage the advantage they have. That is the clear fact why this government is in negative, because if the executive belongs to APC at the beginning of the administration, and the presidency of the Senate, the Senate president belongs also to the same party, the same speaker. So it is unwise not to manage that situation to a situation where the executive will come to the same colleagues, the same friend, the same partners, and they are now opponent. And it is that stigma of being an opponent or an opposition that the Senate president is now attacking the budget. They have not even gone to the committee's level. When they go into committee's level, there will be more controversies between the committee members, because what the budget presentation has shown is that we are going to expect a lot of misunderstanding.
To the detriment of the economy.
But I am of the opinion also, the government has to look carefully that we are moving into political dispensation where there is probably the change of power, either this to continuity or another different system. So our budget also has to face that same controversy, because the behavior of what is going to happen on June 12th, for instance, this year, because our democracy day has been changed from 29th May to 12th June. Yeah. So what we are going to witness possibly around that period is also a concern to us economists. And looking into detail, I am not surprised that we have the same trend of budget presentation, because it's the same crop of people. And since the same crop of people and all the commitment being put together at the federal level is reflecting itself. But there is little change. Refinancing the budget, we have seen situation where there is an adjustment. But the main contention of this budget is that when you go to 1999, where you have a situation where the exchange rate and also production level was below what is obtained today. So in terms of real value, the budget of even 1999 is more significant than the budget of 2019. Why? Because the exchange rate at 305. When you go to PPP, purchasing power parity, where you now put the currencies of two nations and measure it, Nigeria is import dependent, and most of our capital project has to do with expatriate and other commitment outside the economy. So, and it's eating. Even if you double, for instance, in 2015, the total budget was 4.6, or it was reviewed to 4.9 trillion. But in 2018, we are talking of 8.83 trillion,
which is almost double.
But what is the exchange rate? What is the real value of what we are sinking into the economy? These are the challenges. So the central bank, you see, there must be connection between these viable entities, the bank, the Central Bank of Nigeria, the Budget Office of the Federation, the Ministry of Finance. There must be good strategy to ensure that whatever that Budget Office is presenting has been protected by the CBN, by interest rate and exchange rate. Because if you are going for domestic borrowing in the same economy is increasing, 18%, 20%, 25%, which is higher. Or you go for an alternative, foreign funding, probably that less than 10%, but at what commitment? Using your exchange rates, and at what value putting into the economy?
Okay, let me bring you back a little bit to the debt servicing, which is taking over 2 trillion. You alluded to the fact that the debt to budget ratio, it's about 20% to 80% ratio. The more reason we have about 2.4 trillion as debt servicing. Now, is this telling us that it's time for us to march on the accelerator, that the car is moving too fast? The car here being borrowing and debt is moving too fast. We need to step on the brake pedal.
Yeah, you know, we have discussed severally. This administration came with a lot of options, which we continue to counter at different intervals. And we discussed in this house why federal government wanted to sell government asset. And we say you cannot dispose government asset when the value of our currency is low. It's a theft. We look at that option. We also look at an option when at the initial stage, some people behind this government wanted to borrow $29 billion at a time, which we say is not good and it cannot be healthy. And today, the Brookings and Legatum and other financial bodies of the world, including the IMF, are under the doctrine of moral suasion. They are telling Nigeria, please be more tactical in borrowing, be moderate. Yeah, it's a good advice, but where are the funding? I said times with that number, putting large phantom of budget from 5 trillion to 9 trillion is not the question, but the value, the real value of what is going to be invested is the target. And that is why the Central Bank of Nigeria has much to be done. Though I appreciate what Godwin Emefiele is doing with the MPC in trying to put the economy on a stable level. But I always appreciate most time what the National Bureau of Statistics are doing in trying to present data that are necessary. We in economics, especially econometrics, there is no way you test any hypothesis without data.
And there is so much value on data and around the world.
Around the world,
countries are running and looking at the
data-driven economy, and that is why the government has to pay more attention to employing more additional hand expert that can interpret results carefully. The missing gap here is if Bureau of Statistics is raising alarm about, for instance, the poverty line, the unemployment level, the market prices, the same body has to also implore what are the right things to be done.
To be done in a short term,
in a long time. To be positive. Because positive economies always try to bring out the result. Results that will be producing better results. Other economies, we don't want to always be emphasizing on other economies because the commitment they have in their economy, the attitude they have in the economy, and as well as stability. When you look at the budget presentation, you know there is a little friction. Friction in political stability, and it's always a question. How do you expect? Even Mr. President called the attention of the Senate that the world is watching us. The implication of that, many people would look at us as not a serious people, because in some parliaments, you are not allowed to applaud or to boom to anybody. Or yours is just to listen, and after presentation, you take the document and you go quietly because of many reasons. It's an honorable house. Remember, in our culture, local tradition, if there is a quarrel between husband and wife, elders will sit carefully. They don't take party, but from the presentation, they will use their wisdom and conscience to go quietly and resolve matters. The same thing applies to this economy. When in a matter of presenting budget, some of us who have been doing this job for more than 10 years, trying to, and whatever we said, we give us few months. What we say is, you understand what I'm practicing.
So you're saying there is need for people who will interpret these figures that we have out and begin to group them into positive ways of, you know, making impact on the economy. That's what you are saying.
Yes.
In essence, that it's not just enough to have figures.
To have figures. Yes. And there should be
careful interpretation and careful
with the budget office, the National Assembly, and the executive arm. So as the whole will understood why this policy is coming into effect. Not just giving out data, unemployment data rises from 17 million unemployment data in 2018 with so much commitment, and then rising to 21 million in 2019. And also probably not looking at, for instance, the performance of the budget. Okay. It is no good.
Okay, people have called it names. Some said it's a budget of continuity. My guest in the studio said that's also a political language. Others said it's a budget of hopelessness, and he said that's also political. He called it budget of commitment, you know. And another point here he raised was the fact that there is need for a data-driven economy where economists will be able to analyze the data and tell us what will happen in the short, medium, and long term. We've been talking about the 2019 budget that has been presented to the National Assembly and some issues surrounding the budget. And I've been speaking for the last 25 minutes with Yushao Aliu. He's an economist, you know, a proven one for that matter. And he has made so many predictions that I've carefully watched them come to pass over a period of time. And I know that he knows his onions and he knows what he's talking about. Thank you so much for honoring us.
Thank you very much.
This Christmas Eve, we appreciate you're coming here to talk to our guest about this budget and make some clarifications. Well, that's where we wrap up the program today, and we'll be here again tomorrow to tell you what is happening around. There's no Christmas for media people, so don't ask me why we'll be here on Christmas Day. We have to be here to tell you what is happening. On behalf of the lead presenter, Iharata Osaroname Ibizugbe, and Anasan Bala, and the cameraman, and those behind the console walking, I am Gabriel Kumar saying, enjoy the rest of your day.